Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome back to another Monday Night with Bucket and Hoosier. I am Mr. Hoosier, as always, and he is Bucket. And we also always start off with, Bucket, how are you doing?
Buckets is good, man. Thank you for asking again. Mondays, again, I say this every time. I used to get the Sunday scaries going into Monday, but now I am just so excited and feel so good coming into Mondays. Get my workout done in the morning, I eat the frog, and I know at the end of the day I get to come hang out with you. So it's a beautiful day, man.
Eat the frog. You've adopted that completely.
That's my favorite thing. If you get it done in the morning, you eat that gross frog, then you don't have to do it the rest of the day and not have to worry about it.
That's amazing. True. Just knock it out and get it done. They do say, though, if you're trying to lose weight and get in shape, that what was one? I was listening to this one. It said, get up and just like hop on a bike and go ride, like ride it like someone's chasing you down. And then try so hard to not eat because you're going to burn all that and anything like that early in the morning the easiest. So,
yeah, many reasons to do things in the morning, body rhythms, all kinds of stuff. But that's why I get it all done, so I get to enjoy my evenings and hang out and have fun and not have to worry about, oh man, I gotta go get a workout in, or I didn't do this, because I want to enjoy this time and be in these moments rather than thinking about all the things I gotta do.
All the things that you haven't done for the day, basically.
Totally.
What is up, Wi-Fi? How you doing, buddy? Welcome. Well, we do have a very interesting guest today. He goes by the name BelleAir. I listened to him on Boost Over Ball, and we were lucky enough to also have him come on here. Very interesting backstory. I don't even want to talk about it because I can't do it justice. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, here he is, Mr. BelleAir. Sir, how are you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. I've just spent the whole day eating frogs.
You're not supposed to do it the whole day.
Hey, if you got the frogs to eat, do it.
I'm learning, you know, it's been a learning curve for me. Like you're saying with the bike, that's why I keep mine in my bedroom. I just get up in the morning, bike out of my house, wake up everyone, and just eat frogs all day. No, but very glad to be here. Thanks for having me, guys.
No, we're excited to have you on here. So yeah, I got to hear a little bit of your backstory on Boost Over Ball, but if you could so kindly, can you please fill us in with that same story?
Yeah, for sure. It was funny thinking about it because on that podcast, nobody had ever really asked before. We all have these like online names and it's like, oh, so you're just like the person and it's totally separate. But,
right.
You know, yeah, grew up playing sports, played basketball my whole life, baseball at the beginning, like Hoosier, like we talked about before. And, you know, wasn't good enough or tall enough to play in college. So I was just working for the team when I was there. I went to Florida State. I worked for their basketball team while I was there. Got my degree in sports and figured, hey, let's keep this train rolling. So I was working in the NHL for a little bit, and then the pandemic kind of removed a lot of those working opportunities. And along with that, esports. So, you know, kind of found the RLCS, fell in love immediately. Figured this is the stuff I want to talk about and find some people who care about it, because my girlfriend loves me very much but was tired of hearing me tell her how cool First Killer was. So I figured, let me find some friends that'll understand what I'm talking about.
No, that's awesome. I think we're all kind of the same boat on that one, of our significant other going, I don't know what you're talking about and I don't know if I want to care. But they do at the same time. We appreciate them for that.
Context, though. Here's what you do. Let me give you a brief, a little bit of an example of how you make it happen in the background without them knowing that you're getting them involved in it, right? So every weekend, I'll have it on the TV in the morning before everybody gets up and all that, everything just going on. We do have all our normal stuff, but I'm paying attention. Eventually, she starts asking questions about it. Wait, what's going on over here? What's going on over there? Like, don't shove it in their face. Let them fall into it. Make people think it's their idea, and they'll fall in love with it. That's the key.
Yes.
I'm going to take that to heart. I've been tucking my phone underneath your pillow, just playing the Bucket and Hoosier podcast, just kind of indoctrinating. But, you know, she gets it. Like, you know, sometimes she's familiar with, like, apparently Jack and, you know, some of the bigger names. She'll be like, oh, another win. It's good for them. They're kind of improving. I'm like, they are improving. Yeah. They're kind of, exactly. You know.
That's cool. Awesome. Well, okay, so I do want to backtrack a little bit before we get into the esports stuff. So you talked about you worked for Florida State's basketball team. I know you had said that you worked for the Tampa Bay Lightning. And then there was a baseball team you worked for as well, right?
I haven't had the chance to work in baseball.
Okay.
I had a cup of coffee with the Dallas Cowboys, but it was an internship.
Oh, that's right. You did an internship with the Cowboys. Sorry that was the team you went with.
But that was fine. You know, they offered me, they were like, hey, we'll fly you out to Dallas. I was like, don't say anything else. I'm on my way.
No, that's really cool. So what have you done in the traditional sports world?
I would say a lot of it really is kind of hospitality. I mean, of course, when I was still in school, I was the traveling manager for the team, which was super cool. We're in the ACC, so a lot of historic basketball team stuff like that. Basically just show up, wear a tie, you know, rebound some balls. And then I was actually like filming the games. So I was up in kind of the crow's nest or whatever you want to call it, just filming for kind of analysis afterwards. And then, you know, a lot of my like professional life has been kind of hospitality is the nice way of like wrapping in like restaurants and customer service and customer support and things like that. So that's kind of what I was doing for the Lightning is I was a platinum service associate, which basically means I was wearing a tie and a suit and smiling and making friends with the people who spent a ton of money to watch hockey games there. You know, if they need anything, I was the guy with the walkie-talkie who they knew who could kind of figure stuff out.
No, that makes complete sense. So I did kind of something similar. I worked at a concert venue where I worked in the VIP area. So the people that were spending way too much money to be there, and all I had to do was get them in there and make sure they didn't do anything stupid, no matter how much illegal stuff they were doing, just nobody catch them. And yeah. That's a real cool industry to get into. It's actually something that I've touched on in the past year that Buck and I have been chatting, is that I feel like that's something that has been missed when it comes to, I guess, taking care of the talent for Rocket League. Because I've heard some of the stories, say, from like Johnny Boy. Johnny Boy in LA said he was in his hotel room and he had to Uber Eats water from McDonald's just so he could have a bottle of water. And my brain goes to, why doesn't that man have like two cases of water sitting in his room the day he gets there with a fridge that he can load it into? Or someone has a key to his room that's working for Psyonix that goes in there and refills his water. Like my brain went to that, which I know some people will be like, that's way too bougie. And it's like, actually, that's kind of what you need to do so he doesn't have to worry about those things and can focus on just Rocket League. Or even like they talked about getting food while they're... Yep. While they're sitting there trying to cast and they're trying to figure out ordering food. And it's like, nope, that should be set up and ready for them to, hey, step off. I got some barbecue over here for you. Da, 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 da. You like this? I got that. So that's interesting. Do you, in the experience that you've had just talking with an esports, do you even think that there's a chance that Rocket League is to that level, or they're not even thinking of that?
It's tough, right? Because logistics is so difficult. Like it's one of those things where if you have never really done it before, you kind of need crash courses, right? Like you can't just be like, yeah, I'll plan an event.
Oh yeah. If you've never done it, you have no clue where to start.
Like, oh, I'll just like, what's something like, oh, I'll just like plan a wedding, or like, you know, like it seems so easy, but there's so many logistical pieces to it that you're like, oh man, didn't even think about that at all. So it is equal parts disappointing, because Psyonix is like a big established, there's a lot of money and resources and, you know, people who I think are really intelligent that are, you know, on the back end, especially when you think about the production value and things like that. But also at the exact same time, the esport is still so young. Like when you were talking Hoosier, the first thing I thought about was, I think it was Chalkcast. They were talking about how they had this big, basically like Golden Corral style of like buffet for the players, and there were like flies on the food and stuff. And you're like, man, you kind of hope that we can get past some of that. But at the same time, there just are intrinsically growing pains that are built into a lot of this stuff. I mean, you know, it's definitely not at the same level of like my bandwidth on like most esports isn't super high, but it's not League of Legends, right? Like there's levels to this. But I think the RLCS is progressing for sure, you know?
It definitely is progressing. They're slowly getting better. Be curious to hear how this land goes for San Diego, because it is going back to the DreamHacks instead of being its own individual event, which we have heard them talk about. I know I heard Lawler talk about, like, it's still going to be in its, like, own arena. Like, it's going to be, it's still own separate thing, but attached to DreamHack. How much have you heard about it?
Probably roughly what you have. I was just talking to Kyle from Boost Over Ball, and he was saying that he had reached out just like on a flyer to see if he could get like press passes or something. And they were like, we're actually not doing that because this event is hosted by DreamHack. And I was like, oh, that makes sense. So they're kind of, you know, you lose a little bit of agency to DreamHack, which is probably smart because their whole thing is events. It's also in San Diego, where Psyonix is headquartered. So you kind of remove some barriers of, you know, logistical nightmares from there too. So, you know, this event should probably be pretty crisp, I would assume.
Yeah, because didn't they sign a contract with DreamHack that DreamHack's just running all production now for the event? I think that's really how that worked out.
Yeah.
So that makes sense why it is the way it is on for this go around.
For sure.
Yeah, there's a lot going on there. I love the background that you have in helping out with those things. I've dabbled in some of that before, knowing that I wanted to talk about sports. Is that kind of what drove you, that like, let me do something I'm passionate about and get that going as soon as I can in my career? Or what kind of drives you to continue down this path?
That's a way better story, Bucket, and I'm going to take that one. In practice, what happened was I came in with credits from high school, and I came in as exploratory for my major. And my guidance counselor brought me in. She was like, look, man, like, you got to choose a major. You're going to have too many credits. And I was like, I like sports. So sports management it was. But, you know, like, over time, it made more and more sense. You know, there's like some business, you know, aspects to it. I wouldn't have got a lot of those opportunities without it. You know, I definitely, I'm not in the industry right now. I moved online. But, you know, it's, you know, cool industry, dynamic. Definitely doesn't pay as much as some other industries, but hey, you're working with sports, you know, so there's a give and take with a
not the
stuff,
entry
you know?
Level too. That's the thing that people don't understand in some of these positions, because from experience, I was a finance guy and I thought, man, I'm going to make a ton of money in finance and it's going to be great. And then I got into it and the wall started closing in on me and it was gray and my life was boring and I was boring and I had no fun. And then I realized that if I got in to do some things that I love, that once you get past those other barriers, some of them being financial, then all these other opportunities open up. So I'm hoping this is just the beginning for you in finding that stuff. So making the transition to online rather than into physical stuff, what are you doing? Like, how's that going for you?
Yeah, I mean, it's been pretty seamless. I work for a software company, so it's a SaaS tool that we offer. It's a European company, which is cool. So it's international, you know, I get to work remotely and learn a bunch of new stuff. But, you know, really at its core, it's kind of customer service, right? It's talking to people, it's understanding issues, solving issues, things like that. And, you know, honestly, I feel like a lot of it kind of translates into like what we're doing here. I mean, it's obviously not in a perfect one-to-one parallel, but you know what this is and what that is at some level is understanding and entertaining and kind of, you know, building an environment that people, you know, feel comfortable with and want to keep coming back to. So, you know, there's a lot of tangible and intangible things that kind of cross over into both. But I guess to answer your original question, it's going very well. I like what I'm doing, and it allows me to spend more time, you know, showing up to venues like this and making some RLCS content. So no complaints from me.
Yeah, that's fantastic. You can't beat that. I guess my next question would be, from a sports management side, from what you have seen and learned in traditional sports, what are you finding in the Rocket League scene that, or esports in general, well, I guess mostly Rocket League, that they're missing, that they could use as like a lesson from traditional sports?
Oh man, what a great question. I mean, I think of one positive and one negative right away. The positive is it's cool to see that they're starting to do more content around the players. I felt like when I first came in, like season 9, you'd get the talking heads beforehand who are awesome. But then they would just kind of talk and be like, all right, well, they're on the pitch. Like, here we go. But now you kind of have some interviews, some of the content that they're doing for majors that kind of like the face-offs that they were doing. And of course, some of it is like, you know, it's a work in progress because yes. A, it's young kids and B, they've never done it before. But I would say, you know, in a vacuum, it's definitely a positive to have anything over nothing. And then the negative is just, I mean, I'm fascinated by orgs and where they choose to come in and go out. And,
yes.
You know, all of that stuff. Like, that's fascinating. Like, we just saw the Knights are dropping out. They've been around since they picked up Peeps back in the
yep,
day.
Yep, it's another one gone.
Yep. So it is interesting to see how some of these legacy organizations are kind of coming and going. But we're also, it's not a full purge. We're still seeing Elevate just came in and picked up James Cheese. Ninjas in Pajamas just came in and picked up Sam Team. So it's interesting to kind of see the dynamics of where these orgs are kind of placing their money. That's
So it is interesting. Something that Bucket and I have always wanted to know, we understand it's the legality things, like you can't know, but from watching traditional sports, like the thing that generates conversation, especially right now, NFL, for example, it's how much money are people making?
Yeah.
How much money is being floated around? Where are the team caps at? And right now, you know, there is no team caps. Lawler put out a video last week that said that Gen G, collectively, those players are making $500,000 right now. Right.
That's what's up.
And so it's like, wait, so what's everybody else making?
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we've had a big conversations about orgs and, you know, what goes on. How do you start one? How do you make it profitable? And yeah, we're even struggling to figure out how they even stay profitable right now. Aside from like NRG doesn't have the general anymore. Like that was a huge mm-hmm. sponsor. So,
yeah.
And we know those are big contracts that they're paying for those players right now. So how much longer is NRG even going to be profitable? And do
yeah,
they bow?
They did a YouTube video with Shaq, you know, as a
yeah.
huge contract, the general.
Yeah, the general. That was huge. But obviously it didn't. I guess what worries me is that it's not like the general stuck around. Mm-hmm. They vacated. So that while it's good, like saying, hey, yeah, these like they're coming in and trying. It's more that if they're not sticking around, then is it going to be sustainable going forward? And that's the scary part, I think. As we do go forward, because we know some of these players are getting ridiculous contracts right now. I saw they were talking. Somebody else was talking about how that was part of the reason that. Correct me. Who sold Seiko's to BDS?
Endpoint.
That was like part of the reason of them. Which that was interesting to think about. It's like, all right, so this is more like traditional sports now. Like. This guy is holding a heavy bucket on our books and we want to get it off. And another team's like, well, we'll take that off your hands. So then they purchase those rights. So it's like, yeah, it's like the content like that. I want to see that. I want to know that information. It's so hard to find in this scene.
It's impossible, right? I have no idea what basically anybody makes outside of like what you're saying with like Lawler or somebody dropping that information. I mean, let's take like the Knights that just got like if you had to just ballpark how much Cheese, Sosa, and Zaniel are getting paid. You could tell me any number and I'd believe you. Like I have no kind of barometer for what a payroll looks like for these players, you know? And that's just in one region. I have no clue what it looks like in other regions. Like how much are the Falcons making? You could tell me $10, you could tell me $20,000.
That conversation, I am Wi-Fi in chat. I told you this information already. You did Wi-Fi. You are completely right, buddy. You told us. But the thing is that we know some of this, like it changes. Like I want to know what each team is working with when it comes to a contract. And like, I feel like that's almost the next steps for Rocket League is, which is rumored to be the reason why Cloud9 didn't stick around. They wanted a franchise and Psyonix didn't. Did you know that? Were you around in the scene when all that went down?
I was just behind that, so I didn't know that, but that makes sense that that's something that they would be looking for. I mean, that's an org with a lot of capital across a lot of esports. So
yeah, that was right going into 2020 RLCSX, and yep. It was we're coming out of the normal league play that was going on, and they came out and said we're making this change, and it was going to be lands at like every DreamHack and all this and that, and then all of a sudden that's when Cloud9 exited, and the kind of rumor going around was like there was talks of franchising and there was a no vote for franchising, so they're like, well, I'm not risking, I want to know that I'm going to be making I have a bottom line that I'm going to make, and yep. you weren't going to have that. Wi-Fi saying you will never know exactly though with the way it currently is, NDAs block it. My friend, that's what insiders are for, is that they you find out the information. And that's the thing, like Lawler has all the information. I respect him a ton though, because he doesn't just give that information out. He is like the Adam Schefter of Rocket League right now. He knows all of it. What?
And it's like, how much does like Shift know? You know, like they got to know a bunch of stuff behind the scenes too. It's curious how many people know.
They are a good insider as well, because they do seem to get a lot of information out that people are like, you shouldn't have said that. It's like, well, if I find it out and I vet it, then I'm gonna...
What's the point in knowing? That's the matter, right? Like, what's the overall goal in knowing these things? Like, what are you trying to prove?
Content.
For longevity of the esport, for knowing how these things are structured, so that you can just compare people apples to apples. What is the point? What do you think?
Hoosier, do you have a take?
I think for me, it's at this point, it's knowing the players have even talked about they're not supposed to share within each other of how much each of them are making, which because of the NDAs, right? Then to me, that, like, I don't know. I don't want to say it puts an uneven playing field, but I mean, that's what it does, because of an org. Oh, I can pay you this much more, but a smaller org can't. I mean, but that's where, like, we talked, that's why they probably didn't do franchising, right? They don't want to have that stuff. It's just, it's not regulated, but I'm curious how much money is being thrown around for some of these top-notch players that they're getting to come sign for them. Like with Space Station right now, Space Station signs Daniel. None of us know how long they actually signed him for. All the announcement was, we signed him. Now the rumor is he could move. So now are they shopping him? Is he trying to get out of his contract? Like, what is the driving force behind that? And technically, does he still have 2 years left on the contract and he's owed this much money? Like the Aaron Rodgers situation. I just want to know. I want to talk about it. I want to hear Daniel talk about he's going to go do this 3-day retreat in darkness and then come out and he's a new social butterfly that just found the meaning of life.
So transparency, so that you can find out what moves can and can't be made, or what is and isn't possible, right? And that's the parallel to traditional sports, which is the whole question that I want kind of segue into what I think BelleAir can maybe help out with, is like, what kind of things matter to the fans, to the orgs, to the players, to the teams, to the tournaments, to all the things, so that we can make RLCS, like you spoke to this a little bit, into the future, prop it up so that we know this thing can last for a while, because there's been ebbs and flows in the way that RLCS has gone, and there's super fans all the way to people still trying to get into the game, but it's not quite there yet.
I think to tie a bow on the salary thing, Hoosier, I agree with you, and Bucket, I think it kind of, for me, I think the value add is it has to be a yes and situation. Like, just knowing salaries in and of itself, probably, like, if I think about all the possible scenarios and, you know, how some of the like negative kind of panels you can find within the RLCS, I think it's probably a net negative if you just know salaries to know it, but it kind of depends on what situation are they striving for. Because with traditional sports, you have all these different options, right? You think about like international soccer and baseball, where you're fairly uncapped with your salaries, or all the way to something like the NBA, which is very restrictive in what you can do with your budget. You have to spend at least a baseline amount of money. You can't spend over a certain threshold or you're taxed out the butt, right? So it's kind of like, what is the RLCS trying to do and where are they trying to find themselves? That is the benefit of franchising, because you can kind of set a lot of that stuff up, but you also restrict yourselves in a ton of ways too. And you might, you know, chop the head off of a ton of organizations that would want to be in that kind of can't meet the criteria. I don't feel like I know enough about franchising to have like a super informed opinion about it, but I know that didn't like, was it Overwatch that went franchise and that kind of didn't work out super well?
Yes.
So I don't think it's, maybe it's not fruitful for me to be like, hey, that thing I know nothing about didn't work out, so we shouldn't do it. But, you know, it's definitely cautionary, right? Like, you know, the RLCS and esports, it's so new that it's kind of like, it's difficult to know what the very end result is because we're so far away from it. Like, you know, the NBA, that looked like it was going to go completely sideways for a couple of decades until ABA merged with the NBA. And hey, look, now it's kumbaya and it's, you know, 80 years later and everything's going great. And, you know, I think the RLCS has the legs to go on for a while, but I don't know. There's just so many directions and variables that it's kind of tough to, you know what's valuable.
You hit on something that we always talk about, and it's the franchising, and it's the getting the esport to a place where it's a league, so to speak, rather than just an open tournament of all these different teams and everyone can come in. And there's so much that we could talk about and kind of do that. And that's why I think you said you're just not as, it's just not a subject that you know a lot about, because it's a lot. And that segue, we've tried to get into that with several of our guests before that are in the like bubble scene or have some RLCS experience or all these things. And they say it's just going to be all this resistance and all these bad things about it. But one of the things that, going all the way back to the beginning of the conversation, that I would like to see is some sort of rivalry, some sort of story, some sort of things that we can build on top of to like get more people engaged. And that's what I want to see. So is there anything like that that you see, traditional sports or anything from your background or just that you can speak to, that would be really nice to have?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's something that you had brought up kind of at the outset of this, which is, what is your objective if you're the RLCS? If your objective, which I think it should be, which is to just at least put this in the face of as many people as you can to try and see how many fans you can kind of draw into the ecosystem. And there's also to a point, right? Like, you don't just want to be like, let's just put this in front of everyone and it's, you know, it's an unfinished product. Like, you do kind of want to find the delicate balance between showing it to new markets and also not like totally overdoing it and kind of putting yourself in a weird situation. Caveats aside, if you're trying to introduce this esport, and I think one of the big benefits of the RLCS is it's the most parallel to traditional sports that we have. It's effectively hockey mixed with soccer, mixed with cars. Like, that's, you can kind of wrap your head around, it's physics based. Like, it's all pretty straightforward. Like, if I was like, hey dad, come look at this League of Legends game, he'd be like, my eyes are bleeding, I don't know what's happening. If I show him 5 minutes of the RLCS, he's like, I can at least wrap my head roughly around what is occurring here. I think that's a big benefit. The RLCS, and I won't claim it for myself, this was Buttery Hotness who had this thought, but if you go through Twitch and just scroll through the top 30 games that are being played right now, how many of the esports ones involve killing of some form or fashion? I think Rocket League is probably one of the only ones that has no guns, no violence. So if you're trying to kind of appeal to a wide traditional sport audience, something where you can be like, hey, it's just like sports, like it's not like Call of Duty where it's like, oh, it's just like active shooting. Of course, there's a massive market for that. But I'm saying if what you're trying to find is the niche of like, hey, this is cool for your kids to play. You can be involved with this too, because you know what's going on. We're already seeing kind of a foundation being built from high school to CRL to the RLCS. Like, if you're really trying to like look into the future, like somebody who's been doing sports my whole life and, you know, has some sports management like experience, if you want to say that, that is something where I'm like, oh, that's like strong bones, you know, because these could evaporate. Like, who knows? There's some legacy ones like Counter-Strike that just has been around for so long, it's just going to continue. Dota. But a lot of these can be so flash in the pan that when that was one of the things that I was like, I really want to get wrapped up in the RLCS, because I think it's very viable that if they avoid some massive pitfalls, you could find yourself 30 years from now. Maybe it's not the exact same thing, but like this as kind of an engine, I could see this going for decades, you know? And I probably went off on a tangent and got away from your point, but you know,
nope,
that's I think that's a big benefit for
we're all about tangents. Also, the name Buttery Hotness has never come up on this.
Yeah, that's stuck in my head too.
But now I'm staring at his YouTube channel. His logo's great. Go check him out, apparently, because he's got some good takes. Thank you for the plug there. I love finding out about more people to talk to or just to know about or talk about. So love the tangent. Hoosier, what you got, baby? I can see you itching at the palm. You want to keep talking. We've stifled you a little bit.
No, you're fine. I was sitting there taking care of the whiny babies asking for their VIP status in the chat.
Yeah,
so
right.
We took care of that. I mean, I guess it was Papa Rizzo and Wi-Fi. So two people who have been here from the start. So we did kind of owe that to them. Thank you, guys. We appreciate you as always. We didn't forget about you. We're just terrible at this. But yeah, you talked about like, so with traditional sports, like it's the closest one to a traditional sport. You can draw on whether you touched on two of the main sports. I could even throw, I feel like sometimes I can throw basketball into it.
Oh yeah.
So like that's three big sports that, hey, they're like, there's some similar strategy between those that you can bring over here and it can make sense. So yeah, you're spot on there. Kind of wanted to also talk about, you had said in Boost Over Ball, you didn't even want to get into this game. Your buddy asked you. Your buddy Ash said, "Hey, get on here, let's play this game with me." And I think you had the best answer, and I think it's the best answer, and the answer that anybody who is like competitive, or really ends up taking this game seriously, which was, I don't want to, because I'm going to be bad, and then I'm going to want to get good at it. So
I've done it too many times.
What was it that drew, that just sucked you into it?
I mean, really, it was just kind of getting exposure to it. I think with a lot of people, like you said, I've fallen into the trap so many times before, like in like college, my buddies are like really into FIFA, and it's like, great, now like I suck, so I'm gonna have to dedicate a ton of time to this because I can't be bad at this, like it's just not how I can go about doing it. But you know, with Rocket League, just my buddies brought it up so many times, I was like, you know, let me give it a look. And my first exposure was Johnny Boy, like when I just, you know, RLCS into YouTube, which is kind of my, that's my medium, is YouTube and watching videos. I was like, watching some 1v1s, I was like, this is tight. I can see kind of how this goes. And then you're like, all right, well, you know, I'll just kind of pick it up casually. And you very quickly just see how steep the bell curve is on kind of the mechanics of it all, that I just totally fell into the trap, you know, especially early on. Like, you're so bad and you're progressing so quickly that you're like, oh man, I could probably be a pro.
Dude,
I can
get GC in any time. Like, this game's easy.
Man, I'm already gold too. I mean, the sky's the limit, you know? And so you kind of just like fall into it, and then, you know, you're too deep in, you can't really see the forest from the trees, and you know, then 9 months later you're like, oh man, I've already logged like 3 weeks into this game, you know, playtime. So that's kind of how the RLCS, the best trap I ever fell into, I suppose.
Yes, and we all have kind of fallen into that. I've had friends kind of like the same thing with you. They're like, oh, I want to get in this game. I'm like, all right, go for it. And they're like, oh, let me play with you. I'm like, I'm going to make a second account. Well, why? Like, no. And they go, just let me try. Like, it can't be that bad. And I brought a friend in. He goes, the ball's not touching the ground. I'm like, yeah, it's, mm-hmm. it, you progress that far. And it just, it blows your mind. And that's kind of always the fun thing when you bring a new Rocket League player into those higher lobbies. And they're just like, oh, this is what the game can be. Oh, yeah, it just grows quickly. And you just get good or you stay where you're at.
It's better than like Fortnite, where
oh my God.
I introduced some people to it. And the first five lobbies that you get to are just all bots, completely filled with bots, maybe one or two other players who are brand new. And you get this false sense of like, man, I'm going to be really good at this. And then you get a lobby with 75% players and you realize you have no idea what you're doing. I like Rocket League, but a lot of the things people are saying, Smurfs and the fact that there's always someone doing this and that. Is that why RLCS is not a tier one esport right now, because of the player base, because they can't get new players to the game, or is it something else?
I think if I could jump in, I think all of that is just complaining. I mean, I equate it to like, I play a lot of like just going to the court and playing basketball. Like, I don't get bent out of shape. I'm like, this guy's way better than everybody else. Like, this is, it's just how it goes. So I don't really get bent out of shape over stuff like that. And also, I think like the pie in the sky of wanting to be a tier one esport, I think it's silly at some point. Like, I don't really know what does that yield if we just get to call ourselves a tier one esport. I would rather have a smaller group of people who are overwhelmingly invested in the product and just let it kind of grow naturally. Like, that seems like a way better idea to me than just being like, let's just pump the PR machine and just become a tier one esport so we can say it. I don't really, at some point, I don't really see the benefit of that, but.
Well, first, I honestly
love that take.
It's a good one. I hadn't heard anybody describe getting on Rocket League as going to a playground basketball court and playing pickup basketball. That is a perfect analogy, because you're going to run into those players like that. Fun story for me, I almost got shot over a basketball game at a playground pickup game because we were stomping these guys, and they came over from California, and my mouth started running and he was going to silence it. But anyways, but I think with the tier one esport thing that you're talking about, I mean, I think everybody compares it to like League of Legends. Like, you look at their big events that they do, which is primarily over in Asia, because that's where a lot of players are at. Yeah. But like, they filled stadiums to watch these people play League of Legends. And I think that's where it comes from. Like, how do you grow the player base? What do you think it takes to grow the player base? Because that's the people that are going to probably tune in and watch more than anything else.
I mean, it kind of, I think, in a macro sense, I think it really stunk that as a lot of things were kind of coming to this nice point, the pandemic happened. Like, I feel like the seasons that we missed, those majors would have been pretty sick. We were kind of just starting to get into our flow. We had some really awesome teams, like some historic teams, a lot of storied franchises, some legacy organizations that had been around, and all of it was kind of coming to this beautiful point. And I think we lost pretty valuable time and kind of got derailed a little bit, especially as we were trying to introduce all of these regions and kind of build this nice cohesive thing. A lot of that just kind of got a little scattered, but you know, also there's kind of A, nothing you can do about it, and B, it happened to everybody. But you know, I feel like things are going pretty well. You know, I look at it through the small scope of like, let's take just in a vacuum, like creators around the RLCS. When I first came in, like most people, I went to my mediums of choice. I listen to a lot of podcasts and I watch a lot of YouTube. So I went to YouTube and looked for RLCS, and I went to Apple Podcasts and looked for RLCS, and there was like two podcasts, and one of them hadn't come out with an episode in like a year. So if you just compare that to now, where I can off the top of my head name you 8 to 10 RLCS podcasts, like, you know, maybe that's a foolish like sample size to be like, well, now I know more podcasts, therefore it's growing. But, you know, I think it's something like, you know, seems like there's more creators than before and people who are invested in it. So I don't know.
I would agree. I think a lot of us do forget the COVID year slowed a lot of things down. It kept Rizzo from being able to finally get his world title. Like, I think G2 could have done that year. But yeah, COVID did slow a lot of that down and just messed it all up. Like, there, it was supposed to be this grand thing. And we saw so many good teams that were peak then as well that we would have loved to see. Simone Thrax saying in chat, yeah, the NRG and peak and BDS at that time, that would have been amazing on LAN. And I think I think a lot of the hardcore fans are a little bummed to see what's kind of, well, not so much BDS up to Worlds. They did what we all thought they were going to do. But I think it's more of the, if you're an NA fan, it's more on the NRG side. You're like, well, crap, that was supposed to be our knight in shining armor that was going to tackle all of EU, and it just hasn't happened. But yeah, that's a good point to put on. So you are a stats person too. You seem to be all in the stats, and
now we're getting into it.
We have a big old event coming up. It's this thing. It's called like a major. Yeah,
I'm not familiar.
It's hard to keep up with. But so we have the major coming up. One thing I heard you talking about, and I do agree, is how if you're looking at stats for Rocket League, it's hard. Like, you can't just put it all out there and go, well, see, this person has better stats, because players do different things for the team. But who in your mind right now has that full team makeup that is probably going to be a very strong team for the major?
I mean, I feel like it's the dialogue has kind of shifted a little bit, where it kind of seemed like Carmine Core was kind of sneaking into the event. But now I think a lot of people, if you polled kind of the general population, would probably say FaZe are the front runners, right? I mean, they took down Gen G twice in two best of sevens, which is pretty impressive. They won two grand finals. Seems like they're kind of hitting their stride. I think it was a net positive that they dropped to M80, right, to kind of remind them that they can't just kind of walk through the region and things like that. But, you know, they kind of feel like the favorites, and statistically they're a team where the eye test matches what you see on the stat sheet. I mean, you know, you could go on and on about First Killer. Basically, filtering by any random metric you would like, you'll see him in the top 10 of that list. So you know that he's kind of performing. It's in one of the biggest regions, of course. Like, if you just take everybody, you're like, wow. If you've never watched Rocket League, you're like, wow, Virtuoso is like the Michael Jordan of this sport. Like, he's so good. And it's like, oh, well, you know, he's an APAC, and, you know, the stats are a little different and stuff like that. But, you know, I FaZe kind of, it's the ball is proverbially in their court. But I think that actually is part of the equation as to why I'm not picking them as my favorite. I think them being the favorites is kind of no good for a team that has had a shoddy mental.
Oh, you don't want to be the new Aspera?
No. No, I just think if you're like, because if you're FaZe, like, we were talking about this briefly, like, going in front of all of these fans at these live events that you never see. And of course, all three of them, they've seen it, they've done that, they've all been to events. So it's not new to them. They don't have that. But I think a team that historically has made a reputation for always falling short and always coming in fourth place, you know, the Fourth Killer, Fourth Clan, these kind of like monikers that they've picked up. I think if you are a team that you've always had the talent with multiple iterations, but you just have always run up against this kind of hurdle, whether it's actual or not, maybe they just always lose there and it's coincidental. But I think, like, if I was that age and I got fourth place like six times in a row, and now I'm coming into event and I'm supposed to win it, and I find myself in the semifinals knowing that I'm supposed to win it while also knowing that I always lose at this point in time, I don't know. I just think it's better for FaZe to kind of like come in as like a third seed and just kind of be like, you know, chips on our shoulder, we can win this whole thing. You know, I think them being front runners like really is not good for them. But maybe I'm wrong. Who knows?
Yeah, sometimes it's hard to live up to the expectations when you're already at the top and you feel like you should be when there's nowhere to go but down, and you tend to end up in that situation. So I think that's a really good mentality they should have, is not, you know, it's our tournament to lose, but we have to win this thing. I think if they have that mentality, they'll be fine. So we find ourselves talking about the top teams to go to RLCS. What are some teams maybe that are lesser known or that you see here that might have some potential to get through to the tournament round? And does the way the, because each split's a little bit different, the way they organize it, right? Like how each tournament it is, does that going to affect any teams that you see?
Yeah, I mean, I think groups is going to help some of these teams, especially if you're like one of these rosters that have never been here before, like your crew or some of your OCE teams. Like a double elimination, I mean, there's so much pressure that you kind of, if you don't win, it's like, well, we kind of didn't really get any LAN experience, but at least all of them are going to get at least a cup of coffee with these kind of top dogs. But I think it could potentially be treacherous for some of your like momentum based teams. Like I think of Falcons as a team who, like, I think about what was Spring Major when they made the grand finals through the uppers, where it was just like, man, Falcons just get better and better and better. And then as soon as they got the bracket reset against Moist, they got 4-0'd in the reset. Like they just totally crumbled. Or Worlds, like, they come in as one of the top 8 seeds, so they don't even play in any of the group stuff beforehand. They're just sitting there twiddling their thumbs, and then they only play 2 matches and get knocked out. So I think a team like that, if you're kind of rolling in here against a, like, you know, Dignitas and Vitality are some teams that I think a lot of people might think you're probably better than. I mean, if that ship goes sideways, that's a team where, like, you know, that thing could just totally crumble quickly. And they're in, I don't know if you guys have seen, there's like a MENA LAN that's occurring right now. And I didn't keep up with it the last like 2 days, but I was watching a couple of days ago. They look like out of sorts. They're losing to some teams they should not be losing to.
Okay, but I'll you just brought that up because when I heard Johnny Boy talk about this on Chalkcast, made me very nervous again for Falcons. They're playing in a MENA LAN right now. They're not going to get to LA, I think, until like 2 days before the LAN even starts. That is a long day of travel, just getting commercially from their part of the world to the West Coast. I think groups is going to maybe buy them some time, but looking at their group, they can't. Their hope would have to be that they don't drop a game to Vitality and Vitality gets beat by Dignitas and Carmine Corp.
Yep.
So I'm as well as they do look right now, I don't know if that's going to translate to the major. And that actually makes me worried for MENA, because that's not good overall for Rocket League. Like I feel like the Falcons right now are in this weird predicament where they want to help build up their region. Hey, let's make it exciting and whatnot. But at the same time, if you're not performing well on the world stage, then now you're taking away chances to get some of those other teams that you're helping build up into those world events.
Yeah, for sure. Like rule one is just sitting at home, and you know, maybe they show up to this event and they just are completely electric and we're like, oh my gosh, they're so good. But instead Falcons is kind of gatekeeping the situation, as it were. So yeah, not super excited for Falcons, especially against three teams that I think are really well coached, really cohesive teams that are definitely going to be doing their scouting. I don't think Falcons are doing a lot of scouting on, you know, some of these teams, as they're currently like losing to Twisted Minds 4-1. And they're, you know, I try not to read too much into body language, but they just don't look like they're having fun. They don't look like they want to be there. Like, I think those things kind of add up.
I mean, when you talk about, right, like their results, the bracket reset against Moist, they ended up losing. Then you go to Worlds, don't have a good result. And then you play in the first Gamers 8 and you end up in the third, fourth position and still lose to Fury. Like their LAN results have not been good. And I think that's what worries me the most about doing this particular land before the big one. It's like, all right, you might think that, all right, let's give them a boost of confidence before they go. But I almost worry that you're going to hinder them by the time they get there and have to play, because that sleep adjustment and everything is going to be huge for them.
Yeah. It's just, it's so, I think this, like, the way it's structured with the groups is it's the most rife for, like, creating poor mentalities, because in other situations, it kind of just, a lot of teams are going to fall out. It kind of depends. If you're in a group and you get last place in a group, especially with multiple teams that you should probably beat, I mean, man, can you just imagine if Falcons, it's not completely out of the realm of possibility that they go 0-3. I mean, what do you do if you kind of can't show up to this and go 0-3, but also you're the best team in your region, and also you've made a grand finals. So it's kind of like,
and you got a lot of fans too. A lot of people rooting for you, even in North America too, and on not their soil. That's the wild part for those, that team. They have a lot of expectations to live up to.
They could proverbially be in no man's land. You know, like those NBA teams that are always like first round of the playoffs and get knocked out. It's like, you guys just need to, you just need to tank for a little bit.
You're just like, here for us to beat up on. Like, you're my warm up. Yeah. That's what it turns into. And I don't want to see that for them, because they've had so much build up, so much hype, and I want to see them succeed. But yeah, it's frustrating to see that that may not be the case. A team that has taken advantage of getting themselves acclimated to the area, G1 got in place like 2 weeks ago.
Wow.
Yeah, they've, or at least a week ago.
They're in Texas, right? They're at least around. They're hanging out with Arsenal and
Yeah, so they already got into the area. They're like getting comfortable. They had a sweet Airbnb from the looks on Twitter. But I think they could be some trouble in that group A for G2 for sure, and maybe even I think they could put some trouble on FaZe, just because EU defense seems to be a lot better than NA. I mean, NA offense is strong, but their defense isn't the greatest. And especially with how FaZe usually plays, they're very much typically like, I'm going to set up 3-1 1v1 situations and see which one of us can just finally get through your defenses.
Can you imagine just all of the difficulties that North America as a region is? You just trudge through all of it, you secure the one seed, and the group you have is G2, G1, and Crew, who's a complete question mark. Like, they could be awesome, you know? What an awful group for your one seed.
Yeah, and that's that. So the Crew being a South American team, like, to me, though, those teams are scary, because we've seen two very good South American teams come out of there and be able to compete and deliver results. And it's like, uh-oh, is this another one of those? What do we have to worry about? But it will be interesting to see what FaZe is able to do from a game plan situation, and what role Diz can help, how he can. He's helped that team so much. And I'd be very interested to see how much more, like, can they keep building? Or, like you said before, do we see the same FaZe come back? For you, what's a statistic that sticks out to you a lot? Like, one that you really kind of hone in on?
I feel like I definitely overdo it sometimes. And it's always, like, with statistics, you always have to be careful, right? Like, I come historically from, like, the NBA. So there's some stuff, like with the MVP race right now, it's very easy to get real like money ball into like VORPs and like really like deep stats where you're like, well, that's not totally what it looks like. For me, it's like shooting percentage. I think that's really valuable, especially if it's overwhelmingly good or bad on a consistent basis. Of course, even that stat in and of itself lies to you sometimes. Like, if you look at Team Liquid, you're like, wow, these guys shoot terribly, they're awful. But it's like, well, actually, it's because their game plan is to pepper the net and then kind of steal your boost and constrict you and keep this pressure. So that's something that I always look at, but I, you know, with a lot of stats, I think it always has to be informed by the eye test. But like, one that's always stuck with me, we were talking about SAM teams, when version 1 lost to Team Secret in the quarterfinals of the fall major. Beast mode in that series shot 1 for 11. And I feel like that contextually, you're like, wow, what like an awful series from what should be your best player, you know? So sometimes it's really useful. So it's something I always look at.
I love stats like that. And that's such a great point that they have to, you have to see the full picture in order to understand what that stat means, because you can, you see this in the game a lot at all levels, is people are like 56 points. That's all you have. But maybe we won the game. Maybe we won by a lot. Maybe I demoed 8 people, right? Like, so there's other things going on in the game, and it's very important to know. But each of these teams has their own kind of way to go about their business. So my question, and I went to ChatGPT here to ask the question,
yes.
What are some alternate names to call this game Marry, Kill, Screw? If you've ever heard that name, mm-hmm. that game before. So they gave me 10. I didn't even ask for 10. Wed, bed, dead, kiss, hug, diss, date, dump, bump, smash, pass, dash, delete, keep, sweep, dream, scheme, extreme, fame, blame, tame. Anyway, you get the point. I'm going to ask you this about this RLCS. What is a team that you're keeping? What's a team that you're smashing? What's a team that you're passing on? And what's a mm-hmm. team that you think can get in or sneak in?
Do I have to the like full field to the full from?
For to the full to like the 8 to the weekend out of group stages? For it.
I am going to, I mean, I feel like I gotta be married to Team Liquid here. I mean, if that goes sideways, I mean, what a chef's kiss of a group, right? You have Team Secret. They 3-0'd them at the fall major. It was a lot closer. I just rewatched the series like 2 nights ago. It was a lot closer than a 3-0. Team Secret don't really create a lot of opportunities for themselves. But I mean, if that's your biggest competition, a team that you 3-0'd, and then you have Ground Zero, and then you have Game and Gladiators. Oh, like, you got to be so pumped if you're Team Liquid to have that group fall your way. So I definitely got to be married to them, kind of rolling through it. This is tough.
Yeah, it's an interesting one.
I'm going to smash, or whatever the good alliteration ones from the ChatGPT were. I mean, I think Oxygen are in, like, a really good kind of position here. All they did was add more talent. You pick up who has been pretty far and above a lot of his opponents, especially on LAN and Rise. I mean, he's always, pun not intended, but there's no way around it, always risen to the occasion, especially at the international stage.
We love puns. So
there we go. So to pick him up alongside Archie, who at this point is kind of underrated, and any team where the third person you bring up is Jorias, I think is a good situation to find yourself in. So they definitely have their work cut out for them. Complexity's no slouch. Gen G, of course, is an incredible team, and Pioneers, who knows what we're going to see from them. But that's a team that is definitely intriguing. Who am I going to kill? This is so tough. I mean, some of these are too lazy to be good picks. Like Gladiator right. is unfair. Let me go ahead and maybe it's because we were just talking about them, but
maybe we should have done like the top 8 qualifiers, but still, yeah. Like someone in the middle, someone that you think other people might be putting on their list as a good one. Like, who's someone you're like, eh, not even worth my time to talk about?
I'm gonna
he's gonna say G2.
No, I'm not. I really like G2. I'm gonna kill. Let me kill Vitality.
All right. I was looking at them too.
Oh, okay.
It was between them and G1, but I think they kind of have a nice kind of puncher's chance there. I mean, just so much pressure surrounding that team. Of course, Zen is looming over like a black storm cloud. He's coming in next split. So not only are Sazen and Radosin showing up to the international stage for the first time in their careers, but also, hey guys, try not to suck, but also if you do suck, we're probably going to bench you. Isn't like
yeah.
the optimal situation to come into. We haven't seen Alpha here in a while. That group is not an easy group. I know everybody just thinks Dignitas is a pushover, but I kind of like that team. I think they're feisty. I think they could take definitely games and maybe some series off of these teams here. So, you know, Vitality and Falcons are in awful situations. So I'll kill Vitality as they're kind of the darlings for a lot of people, I think.
Interesting.
I love that. Hoosier wants to chime in. Who you got on that list, Hoosier?
My one that I think is going to sneak out and catch everybody by surprise is Gaming Gladiators. I honestly, after hearing them on Chalkcast last week and them being
their coach is Marky Duda.
Yeah, their coach is Marky Duda. And
oh, you're in.
Yeah, and like they seem to have it figured out of like strats, and they're committed. I think they were already here as well. They were hanging out with James Bot. He had helped put them up for their time before going to the LAN. So like they're here, they're ready, they've been playing, getting comfortable. So yeah, I think that's a team that will get out of their group, and then depending on who their first matchup is, I think can make it kind of interesting. And make a good showing for the region for APAC. So it's for me that's my sneak through one. The team I'm gonna kill and just get rid of. I hate to do it. I think it'll be G2. I hope not, but I'm looking at that group and I don't know. I don't know something.
That would be a big fall for them, 0-3. But you're right. It's a group A. Anything can happen in any of these groups, honestly.
Yeah. So I think that's where it gets real interesting. If I'm gonna marry a team, like this is the team I'm riding with, especially since V1's not here. Not picking FaZe. I never pick FaZe.
No, you don't. I've never met anyone who just will not get on the first killer train as much as Mr. Hoosier.
Nope. I do not. My gut wants me to go Gen G, but I worry right now with I feel like Appjack is missing his killer instinct right now when it comes to finishing games. It feels like I don't know, like the team as a whole, it just kind of gets a little lax, so I don't know where their mental is going to be at going into LAN. I think they do want to make it, like, obviously they want to win, make a very good showing. They've started out very strong in their first year in NA, but I'm going to go with Complexity. I think Complexity has made such a huge turnaround right now that they could make a good, strong run here at the major. So, but what do you say, Bucket? Where are you at on this?
Digging it, man. I'm going to make this short and sweet. Really, I'm going to probably marry FaZe. I'm actually going to go the opposite and say I'll bed Gen G and I'll get rid of Complexity. Get out of here. They're not. I don't want to talk about them again.
What a stooge.
Yeah, I want to take the opposite of you every time.
Every time. You always do.
That's why I ask
when he zags.
Every time. How often has that worked out for you?
Well, I don't ever want to be in a conversation where we both were like, hey, we were both right. Good game. And
that's true, right?
Tap. I want to be in here and I want to be telling you how wrong you were, or you to be telling me how wrong.
Oh, my Lord. Yeah, no. I
think BelleAir had the right take, though. I think that's if I would have went first, somewhere along those lines would have been kind of where I was. So go ahead, Hoosier.
No, it was a good take. Kind of some back along like stats. You've said this catchphrase, the tagline, a couple of times while we've been on here, and that's Moneyball. Mm. And do you think you could Moneyball a Rocket League team together?
In which region?
NA.
Oh man. That's tough treading, I think. I mean, you can find value. I think a big thing is finding like young talent, like Dignitas grabbing Evo, and he wasn't even their first choice. They were going to pick up Magic Bear after the whole kind of thing shook out, but then they retracted that and picked up Evo. I mean, what just a brilliant decision that's been. He's looked pretty transcendent at points in some of these games.
Well, and according to Ryze, Evo's even reached out to Ryze after all that happened, and he told Ryze, thank you.
Thanks, man.
I appreciate that, because he gave the Ryze situation kind of guaranteed his slot into actually making it.
Yeah, I mean, but NA is so weird, because I feel like the lines are a lot more clear on kind of the pecking order, especially if you're going to kind of like group it, than like Europe. Like Europe, any of these events, that's why it's so exciting. Like almost, you know, let's take 13 of the 16 teams have a pretty, you know, you could make a story for them kind of making a quarterfinals or something. I feel like in North America, I think we also like to talk about it like it's a lot more top heavy than it actually is. But, you know, a lot of your like your Team Axels and your who are some teams that are kind of around there? Your Knights, who just left, NRG are kind of a little higher than they are. But I just don't know if you have the same talent down there that you do up top. But I would kind of look at some of those teams like Sosa from Knights, Toasty from Axel. Those are some players that probably have a lot more value than their squads are giving them right now. But, you know, I gotta know the contracts. Is Wi-Fi still in chat? He should spill the beans and tell us how the contracts work.
He has spilt the beans on here before. This was very early on episodes, so Buck and I need to bring him back on and chat again. He has spilt some of it. I mean, the money you make in North America, it's a good chunk of change. That's why, you know, Nolly and Appjack came over from EU. So they're like, oh, I don't want to. I have a better chance of making more money there. That's why the GOAT himself, Turbo Pulsa, had moved over from EU first. You can have your smirks over there all you want, my good friend. But that's why he moved, and it worked. It worked out in his favor money wise. So, well, and he won another world championship. So you can't.
That doesn't hurt.
No, that doesn't hurt at all.
Yeah.
He's a turbo hater. He just,
you just can't go one episode, 1 week without talking about him. It's just a broken record.
It was teed up like a little kid's T-ball.
Give me a break.
Like you have to talk about him. He's the GOAT. But
he's got the Bill Russell Award, 4 titles.
Right? Like
if Turbo had 2 titles though, maybe what Bucket is getting at. If Turbo had 2 titles, would we even consider Turbo around here? But
no.
It's revisionist. I understand that.
I would completely agree with that. If he didn't have 4 titles and wasn't able to perform the way he did that many times and get to the championship and win it, I would agree. I know the asterisks everybody would put on it is like, well, so his titles, 2 of his titles are not full season length. Like they're almost like one's like a major. It's like, well, but it was a title back then, so it counts. Like,
yeah,
check mark.
Bucket, sorry for stoking the turbo flames a little bit.
Not at all.
Hoosier's into it. Oh, what do you think about Turbo?
I actually don't have any problem with Turbo Pulsa. It's just even at the end of his career, and here's one of the things: Hoosier's just like he's gonna pull back. He's gonna make it, and we haven't seen anyone really make that turn before. But he had this belief, and he's held on to it like a dying flame on a lighter that's going out at a concert of 75-year-old rock stars that no one cares about anymore. He just won't let it go.
Until the day he retires, yes, I will hold out hope.
Forcibly or otherwise, he is
exactly
understandably going to retire. So anything else about RLCS that you want to mention here, BelleAir? Because I want to ask you a little bit about like kind of your YouTube stuff and video stuff before we get out of here, if you have time for that. But RLCS-wise, I mean, I think we covered a lot of ground, but it's coming up so quick. I mean, I'm finally getting excited for it. There's such a big lull in between. It's hard to like get excited until about now, a week and a half before.
For real, especially when all of the predictions that we're making as a community are fruitless because we're all going to be wrong. Like there's going to be one of these teams that are going to be way better than we thought. Remember like what a wash, like Team Secret last time. It was like, they're showing up. Like that'll be fun. They make the quarterfinals or the semifinals. So there's going to be a team like that out there. Who knows who it's going to be? Maybe it's a G1. Maybe it's, you know, crew for some easy historical kind of look at Sam continuing to do it. Maybe OCE pop. They haven't made a playoff since Chiefs made it in season 4. But, you know, all predictions about the RLCS are fun and wrong. So nothing really there. Major's going to be awesome, though. I'm really looking forward to it.
Is this going to be your... No, you said you went to Worlds, right?
I did, and I'm not going to this one.
Yeah, I won't be either.
It seems to be the case these days. A lot of people who have been to multiple are now not either able to make it or they've been there, done that kind of deal. What's the reason?
It is as far away as possible within the United States.
You are on the other side. Excuse. I guess that makes sense.
Yeah. That's was like, fair. You know what? I should just bite the bullet and just go. I was like, a ticket, that's not that bad. A flight, I can, you know, that's not that bad. And then I started looking at Airbnbs. So I was like, you know what? I'm probably going to do a better job as an analyst if I watch from home. And that's the lie I'm telling myself.
It's like Archer football.
Exactly. You know,
and it's Easter too. Papa Rizzo. I've heard this a bunch of times. People have actually had to bow out because they didn't realize it was Easter until it came up again. One of those holidays that you don't realize you don't until it comes up that it's actually right here, right now.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It sneaks up on you. That's for sure. So how did you get into YouTube?
Direct question. How'd you get into YouTube? And tell us about some of the videos, because a lot of them are about this topic. Like, these teams are going to land. This is what happened. Like, what? How did your YouTube start and kind of the progression of it?
It started as an NBA channel.
Really?
If you go back into the videos, yeah, that was kind of the jumping off point. I mean, I've consumed, you know, a college school work of YouTube video. I watch YouTube all the time. It's my medium. Like, the visual audio kind of component is my jam. And so it was always one of those things that I was like, that would be super cool to do, is to make YouTube videos. But, you know, especially when I was younger, I was just completely paralyzed by the idea of putting stuff out there. If it wasn't going to be the best possible thing, then I wasn't going to do it. And so I just didn't do it for a long time. And, you know, finally ripped off the Band-Aid when I just told myself, like, you just got to start doing it or you're never going to get better at it. And then I started to realize how deep the NBA rabbit hole was on YouTube. There's so many creators, right? It's been around for so long, substantial audience. And also, I was kind of upset with myself because I didn't feel like I was... as informed as I wanted to be making videos, especially because a lot of my free time was starting to get dedicated to watching Rocket League. Like, coming in so much later and there being so much history, I really started going back into like the old seasons and stuff like that. And I was like, why would I keep like beating myself over the head trying to like scrape together NBA videos when I could just make Rocket League videos? Like, that seems like it's a lot more appetizing. And, you know, of course it's the same thing where you're getting in, you're like, well, I can't really talk about this because I'm not an expert. Like, if all you consume is Johnny Boy and Lawler content and then you're like, hey guys, listen to my opinion, it's like nobody cares. You know, but, you know, it's progressing. I really like that things have been progressing bit by bit. It's very cool. I also am a really big fan of it not growing super fast, because I can try a ton of different videos and see what works and what doesn't. If you go back and just click through a couple random videos of mine, I bet all of them are going to stylistically be completely different, because I'm just trying different stuff, you know, see what sticks, see what I like, see what other people like listening to and watching. So it's been a cool kind of growing process, I guess.
That's wonderful. And I cannot say enough about the things that you just said about how a lot of people want to just be perfect and button it all up and tie it in a little bow and then send it off as great as it possibly can be. But what did you learn there, right? Or was that even what people wanted? Do they even want to open this package up? Was the package as good as you really thought it was? You don't know that stuff until you go out rip the Band-Aid, like you said, and get it. We've adopted that philosophy here on the podcast. I've done it in my life with pretty much every aspect. Is like, just do a little bit, just do a little bit, just do a little bit. And before you know it, you have something that you can be proud of and you're excited about. You continue to grow and adapt and all that. And this sounds like what you're doing. So what have you learned? What are the things that you are gearing towards that you think are working for you and how you continue to grow?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question with a lot of scattered answers. I mean, not to get like too philosophical about it or anything like that, but you know, a big struggle of mine is just doing stuff consistently. There's always reasons why you can't do stuff, especially when you're talking about like creative stuff with YouTube, especially. Like, I really struggle with fighting the kind of perfectionist urge of, I've had videos that have basically just sat and collected cobwebs for like 2 months just because I tell myself it's not good enough, but really subconsciously I'm just afraid that people will say this is bad, so I don't finish it. But you know, I think I've kind of learned that a lot of those videos are the ones that actually kind of end up coming out pretty nicely. Like, really, it's cyclical, right? Like, where you put out a video and you're like, man, I feel super like proud of myself and I feel good, like this is a feeling that I should try and replicate, and then you sit down to start making the script for the next video and you're like, oh, I don't want to do this. So you have to just remind yourself of where you mentally found yourself previously, you know, to kind of like prod yourself to keep the cycle going or whatever. But you know, another big thing is like, you start out kind of just copying people that you see, and that can kind of get stale at the beginning, but you have to keep putting stuff out to iterate, because I found myself like basically just like copying Johnny Boy videos and like just like not being happy with it, because it's comparing yourself to Johnny Boy, who has been doing it for hundreds of videos and knows exactly what he's doing and sounds really polished and all of that. And so, you know, also the process of figuring out what I like making, you know, like, I could make, I had one, I challenged myself to come out with a video every single day for a week, and I did it, and I learned through that process, man, I really don't like making those videos. Like, I should make something else. So, you know, it's all kind of a Venn diagram of just trusting the process, I guess, is like the dumbest way to put it. Like, you just gotta do stuff. You just gotta do stuff.
I think that's the old school way of thinking of it, and it, yeah. There's a reason that it works. You trust the process. Like, it's a process. It's not gonna be just overnight all of a sudden. And if it is overnight, then good for you. But for the majority, it's not gonna be. So you need to just go through the motions and see what you can figure out along the way. And it seems that you're having real good luck finding some success in doing that, which does help drive you to keep doing it, which is awesome.
Yeah, reflecting on it, it's been going very well. The process up until this point has felt like it's been like at points going terribly, which, you know, I'm sure you guys, like, maybe you guys have felt at some point where it's like, man, this is like tough, but then you kind of look back at it and you're like, man, this is actually going better than I thought. And it's kind of one of those things where, not to keep beating a dead horse about it, but this recurring thought I have of like, envision yourself if you were to have done this for as long as you wanted. Like, if I would have come out with a video for all the time I stalled on making YouTube videos, what if I had made one video every 2 weeks? Well, by now I'd have 100 videos. So when you kind of put it into perspective like that, where it's like, you just got to do stuff now, and then over time it will accrue. I don't know. It's just, you know.
No, that makes complete sense. Like, we talked about in our pre-show like meetup, you know, that's kind of how our mindset was for this podcast last year, was can we do it? And we found myself in Bucket, there were days where I know I didn't like really want to come on, but I'd get a text from him, hey, we're doing it, yep, I'll be there. Or I would message him like, hey, you're still good? And yep. And so we'd go through it, so we finally found our, you know, got into the rhythm of it, and now here we are in year two, kind of doing like you said, like you were doing with your stuff. We're just slowly building over time. Hey, let's try this. See, is it sustainable? Do we like doing it? And does that process work for us? So I think that's good advice to anybody out there wanting to start streaming, videoing, podcasting. Yeah, don't shoot for the moon, but don't kill you. Don't think that you failed just because in 2 weeks it didn't take off.
Yeah, for sure.
I have
more thoughts. I don't want to keep talking.
No, you're preaching to exactly what I've been preaching forever, and that's a few books just to note. Like, I don't know if you've read them, Atomic Habits, Compound Effect, these books that just say doing is better than not doing. And mm-hmm. then once you do them, you do a little bit and a little bit, and before you know it, you've got something built. And if you just sit here and talk about it or make a plan or say, I'm going to do it, it just doesn't come to fruition. So it sounds like you're doing, and doing is better than not doing. And we're getting content out of it. And it looks like hundreds and sometimes thousands of people are coming and checking out to see, hey, what's this guy got to say? And that's where you want to be at, right? Like, it's not about finding 100,000 views immediately, because you want to grow as yourself. So any other advice, anything else you want to say about that? Cause I love that stuff. It speaks to me.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I guess one other portion of it is like, I think people early in the process, the result that they're basing their, the metric they're using to like judge their results is how many people are looking at it, but that's actually like not a valuable thing at all. I actually think it's a benefit that not a lot of people are watching my stuff, because I effectively have no pressure from anyone outside of myself to do stuff. Like, if my first video for the RLCS I put out got like 100,000 views, I'd be so nervous to like chase the dragon on another video. Like, having 300 people consistently watch is like just exactly what I want at this point, because I'm still trying to figure out, you know, what I'm doing. And, you know, just because it's not for somebody is actually a good thing. Like, somebody seeing your video and being like, this isn't for me, it's like, okay, cool, so I learned that this isn't for you. But the value of growing small, in the same way, to tie it back to the RLCS, not trying to do a dead sprint for being a tier one esport, it's nice to grow naturally with the people that actually like your stuff. Like, it is very cool now, in the same way you guys probably have with the podcast. It's really fulfilling to like check my YouTube comments and know basically for a fact that there's at least 5 or 6 people that have definitely commented on the video. Like, that's cool. It's like people that, you know, are kind of part of it now, you know? So that's I think better than just having a ton of views. But That's all I'll say about it.
I love that tie-in to RLCS, because it's such a good segue to this whole conversation, was that we hear all this stuff from the outside, the noise, like, it needs to be big, this needs to happen, that needs to happen, but it is where it is, and let's continue to build on top of that one layer at a time until we get it there. But a little bit more direction, a little bit more transparency from the other side, from Psionics, would be nice. Obviously, there's things that we want from both sides, but that's all I'll say about that. That's a whole other can of worms.
We don't wanna... So before we get out of here, BelleAir, where can people find you at?
Yeah, I basically just exist on Twitter and YouTube. I'm at BelleAir Baller. YouTube is a lot of stats and analysis, kind of looking at some game replays previously, but now I'm trying a new style. Very soon I'm going to have a video about how speed has historically changed from the beginning of the RLCS till now, and kind of what stats have adjusted and kind of the flow of that. So that'll be coming out soon. And then on Twitter, just trying to pump out some stats, basically nuggets that I find that don't make the cut on videos, or kind of precursors for videos and stuff like that. So at BelleAir Baller is where you can find me.
Awesome. Well, we did link that in the chat. We will also put that in the show notes on the podcast. Be sure to check that at the bottom. I honestly can't wait to talk to you after the major and see what stats are out there and how it's all looking. And I mean, maybe we'll bookmark this. Maybe we'll let the major pass for a full week so we can see the full stats, break it down. Then we'll have to bring you back up here to break down what happened at the major and how teams performed.
Hey, I would love to come back. This is an awesome time. I really appreciate you guys. Let me come on and be your third guest. That's, yeah, I appreciate it.
Hey, we're also looking for people who know how to do YouTube because we're just trying to figure that out too. So, hey, we can maybe help each other out in more ways than one.
Let me know. You guys got the vertical video overlays figured out, so we'll swap some. We'll talk some shop.
Oh yeah, screen. Lots of good stuff coming out.
Awesome. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is BelleAir, sir. Thank you for joining us, and we will catch you another time.
Thank you so much, guys. I appreciate it.
Thanks, man.
All right, Bucket. Well, we're here at the end. I mean, we talked about a lot of good stuff in that segment there, in that interview with BelleAir. He's so knowledgeable. Just knows so much.
I
know. Much.
We didn't even really get to scratch the surface of like the context of some of his videos. And that's why I wanted to touch on it on the end, because the conversation went really well in the case of like where we're going here in the next couple of weeks, like a big, huge high level. We kind of brought it down into RLCS, a little bit of the game knowledge, but we didn't even get down to the players, the stats, the teams, the individual stuff. And that's kind of some of the stuff that he does too, right? Like he goes through reviews, goes through what's happening. So there's so much more context to continue on with him. So I'm excited about that. I love having repeat guests. We've had several of them. We've had people who we learn from, and hopefully they're getting something from us too. Otherwise, what are we doing here, right?
Exactly. But yeah, I think that's going to do it for us tonight. We basically covered everything.
One more thing, right? Like, next week we have a secured guest I'm pretty excited about. If you're here right now, we'll tweet it out. We'll try to get some more hype. But he's facing off tomorrow against John Sandman in a show match. It's Savage, the 8-year-old prodigy Rocket League player, and his dad are going to come on. He's even going to let him stay up a little late to come hang out with us. And I'm excited about that. He's going to play him tomorrow, John Sandman versus Savage, on stream. I think it might even be like a fear thing. I'm not sure.
I think it is being done with fear.
Yeah, I think it is. So that'll be pretty big, and he'll get a lot of hype from that. And then he's promised to come hang out with us after that on next Monday. So it's a really good time for us to get to know some of these people after they get some things done. So that's really, really exciting for us, because we've been following him and watching him throughout his short career that has a lot of potential. So come on back for that. But other than that, Hoosier, I'm done with the soapbox stuff.
I think that covers it all. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in tonight. We appreciate you as always. If you are listening on a podcast, be sure to follow and hit that notification button so you know when the next episode comes out. And that's going to do it for us. You guys have a good one. We'll catch you next Monday. Good night, guys. And we'll cut this out of the pod because I didn't hit the raid button in time. You guys are going to another try house, though. Catch you guys later. Bye.
I think you still can.
I didn't hit the start button in time. All right, BelleAir, are you still here?
I'm still here. 8 years old.
Yeah, yeah, he's nuts.
He's GC3. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
That's wild.
He's his dad's been around in some of the dad stuff, and that's how we kind of came across him. But he's gotten on to like a lot of big YouTubers stuff already as a 8-year-old. I think some of the higher up even players have taken them under their wing. What was that? We did that charity stream with the guy who was SSL, the pro player. And they were friends, like they had met before, him and Savage. And so I got a hold of his dad, and his dad was like, yeah, we'll come on, and it's gonna be cool, it'll be fun.
Yeah, it's really cool. And he was like, wait, he's like, he's doing this match against John, do you guys want to talk to him before or after? And I made the executive decision. I was like, we're doing that after. I want the results come out for that and see what happens.